Animals. From the earliest eons of Earth's formation to our distant futures, animals have always been around. Even if humans are long gone one day, animals will continue to prosper and thrive, whether they're in the deepest waters of the ocean, the hottest lavas of volcanoes, or even in deep space. Each and every animal is equally unique and interesting. And really, what's not to love about them? There are cute animals, cool animals, scary animals. Hell, there's even animals that make you say, "What the hell? How is that thing real?" In this day and age alone, there are an estimated 8.7 million different species living among humans to love. But what if that isn't enough for you? What if all those millions of living creatures don't just cut it for you anymore, and you wanted to obsess over creatures that don't exist? Well, those people are called archaeologists, and you should avoid them. But if you want to be the coolest little anthropologist on the playground, listen up, and let me tell you about speculative evolution. Speculative evolution is a field of pseudoscience that actually acknowledges how wild and wacky everyone interested in it is. And it mainly exists just for entertainment. Just look at some of the early works, like Man After Man and All Tomorrows. The first one has giant bear people with little buddies living in them, but the other has alien genetic engineers, farting space Martians, and bird people. If it isn't clear from these images, speculative evolution is a very broad field, and you can put as much creativity into it as you want, so long as whatever kind of creature you want to invent can technically exist, which coincidentally is the same as my dating standards for women. But before we go deeper into speculative evolution, let's break down the field. It's split into two parts, speculative and evolution. The speculative aspect of speculative evolution is simply referring to the fact that it's completely speculatory. We are just making guesses or inferences based on the data we know, and theorizing what could potentially have existed or what potentially will exist. In order to make those guesses, we analyze trends in evolution. I would hope everyone watching this knows what evolution is, but knowing the American school system, I'll give us all a quick rundown. Basically, the theory of evolution states that any given animal over the course of generations will change to better fit its environment. Effectively, it's summarized with the phrase, survival of the fittest. Let's say you have two animals of the same distant species, say an ancient dodo bird. The first version of the dodo bird feasts primarily on fruits and lives in isolated islands. It becomes fat, and because there's no natural predators, it eventually loses its ability to fly, becoming the dodo bird we know and love. Now let's say the other ancestor, the distant cousin of that first primitive dodo bird, instead found an Arctic wasteland. They grew thick fat to survive and were forced to swim in cold waters to hunt fish. Rather than grow fat, these animals grew faster in order to better catch small fish and eventually became completely distinct animals. Even though you might look at one of these creatures and say it's clearly superior to the other, the truth is evolution isn't as a straight line as some people would like it to think. Survival of the fittest should really mean survival of whoever best fits the ecological niche. Basically, there's a theory that any animal in a given ecosystem fills a certain role in the food chain, and evolution, in turn, will make that animal better suit its own role. This would mean a simple herbivore creature like a bunny would be more likely to, say, evolve to run faster, rather than just suddenly gain laser-blasting eyes. This can actually be proven historically by looking at popular examples of ancient creatures. Even millions of years ago, primitive jellyfish and crocodiles look almost exactly the same as their modern-day counterparts. It's similar to sharks in that sharks today and in the past fulfilled the same role, so they evolved the same traits such to fit that role. This is why you could find animals, like the penguin and the puffin, that look so similar despite being completely unrelated to each other. They fulfill the same niche, therefore they evolved very similar features despite not actually being related. With this in mind, speculative evolution seeks to hypothesize what evolution could theoretically do to a given creature over enough time. And heavy emphasis on the word technically there. Today, however, we'll be focusing on a more grounded speculation, specifically for two modern species, small birds and large birds. Even more specifically, feral rock pigeons and the Australian black kites. So how did these two little creatures come to be? In order to guess what kind of beings they'll evolve into, we have to understand what creatures they evolved from. Pigeons are actually a semi-domesticated version of a already existing species known as the wild rock dove. They're almost entirely the same, except that one lives in urban areas and the other nests in cliffs in the wild. These birds, although they live in completely different conditions, are still technically the same species. And it is believed that these birds, as well as the black kites, originated from some distant bird ancestor. In truth, flight is a very complex evolutionary path that takes eons of evolution. From walking to gliding to finally being able to fly yourself, it requires a lot of advanced traits, such as hollow bones, a small enough stature to be able to fly, and of course, wings instead of opposable arms. So where would that leave us then? Well, let's start with the pigeons. You know them, you love them, unless you're from New York. So how do these little fatties survive? Well, they kind of wouldn't. Turns out being an annoying city rat is not really a viable survival strategy. Unless you're one of those cool 2 feet long rats that just attack people nonstop, or are turtles from a 90s cartoon. Because these birds are already going extinct in the wild, so it is unlikely that pigeons would evolve to be less dependent on humans, assuming humans live that long, and the surface is inhabitable. But, assuming those conditions, I speculate that pigeons will diverge into two distinct types, the traditional flyers and what I call the snuggle bugs. But how would this become this? Well, if you've ever tried to eat outside before, you would know that there are always pigeons just around the corner, waiting, watching carefully for you to slip up so they could steal your food and credit card information. Trouble is, there's a better, probably easier, way of getting food, begging. A lot of birds are starting to discover that simply by walking up to people, kids will start throwing fries at the birds that they deem cute, fluffy, and most importantly, fat. These foods, though, aren't necessarily made for bird consumption, and since it's harder for them to digest, it leads to them becoming heavier and larger overall, which would then mean humans find them cuter, leading to more food, and so on and so forth. Eventually, the most successful birds will become so large that they can't fly, kind of like penguins, but if they were Discord mods. This would be an important point in the pigeon evolutionary history. One of the main reasons pigeons fly isn't actually so that they can find food, but to avoid predation. However, if pigeons do so well at getting human attention that they become too fat to fly, that would mean their species would either have to die out or evolve. In this case, I'll make the assumption that the pigeons eventually develop a fatty layer of protection to stop rats and cats from just murking them on the ground. Potentially, they'd evolve bigger claws so they could dig small holes near restaurants and in the dirt to hide from other animals. Or maybe they'll grow even bigger with larger wingspans that are now unable to fly, but possess enough strength to beat back any larger creatures that would try and prey on them. These birds would effectively follow the path of the ancient cat. They would originally live next to us humans in blissful ignorance before realizing, hey, these guys have a lot of food. And over decades and decades, the pigeons would slowly let their guard down around humans, becoming more and more comfortable being next to them, to the point where they eventually rely completely on us for food and nourishment. It would effectively be domesticating themselves. Funnily enough, wouldn't even be the first time this has happened in human history. While New York would be prospering with the little snuggle bunnies, in Australia, the birds could be developing a significantly cooler form of finding food, becoming arsonists. I know if I tell you, you're not going to believe me, so I'm just going to let this little video clip explain.
Okay, birds, of course, don't start a fire on their own. In any case, people have not seen anything like it yet, but they make excellent use of the flame, which has already started burning. At least three Australian species, the black kite, the whistling kite, and the brown falcon, are considered serial arsonists. Or rather, firehawks. The primary source of the fire can be a forest fire caused by lightning or any other cause. All you need to do is just wait, and fire will certainly spread around. All that's left is to grab the burning stick with talons or take it in the beak and carry it to the right place. I wouldn't be surprised if it turns out the birds even thought of pulling branches out of the bonfires.
Yeah. I'm being fully serious here. All things considered, the ability to wield fire is significant for any animal. In fact, on the tech tree, one of the most basic forms of civilization is the ability to create and use fire, the ability to cultivate livestock, and the ability to live in an organized society. These birds would effectively be fulfilling one out of the three conditions by default, making them way ahead of other animals in terms of technology. These birds would most likely become even faster and even deadlier, perhaps gaining opposable thumbs on the end of their wings like rats so that they can more easily maneuver flaming objects as they throw them down on helpless villages while people burn. It's funny to think about, but the future of these birds could literally be paved in blood and fire. Now, I doubt they'll ever be able to fully control fire. See, tying back to one of the main issues with being a bird, they have wings, not hands. Humans could harness and later make fire because we had the ability to just kind of throw rocks at each other a bunch until they started a fire in a designated area. Birds, though, will have a lot trickier of a time. Sure, they could use their beak to chuck rocks at each other and hope something happens, but they don't really have any way of containing said fire. So I would assume that these birds would only continue developing their mastery of utilizing pre-existing fires to keep spreading them rather than ever evolving to create them on their own. That being said though, these birds can also thrive off of human expansion. Back in the old days, you used to rely on lightning for fire and pretty much nothing else. But if humans continue to expand and these hawks start moving into rural, suburban areas, there's always the chance that they could start pickpocketing some of our lighters, maybe taking a twig and rushing it against a campfire before flying off to start the next Californian wildfire. It's a terrifying future, but pretty funny to imagine, all things considered. Either way, this video was just meant to be a fun little dive into the world of speculative evolution. I hope you learned something. Because I sure as hell didn't. Have a good one, and I'll see you next time.